If one considers political science as the scientific background against which the fantastic claims plausibility, utopian fiction is the first tributary of the river of science fiction. By examining key works like Plato's Republic, Thomas More's Utopia, Francis Bacon's New Atlantis, Jonathan Swift's Gulliver's Travels, Samuel Butler's Erewhon, Edward Bellamy's Looking Backward, and William Morris's News from Nowhere, we can see that utopianism has developed in four large historical movements corresponding to changing conditions of material production and religious belief. In the 20th century, the grim archetypal utopia of Yevgeny Zamyatin's We, a critique not only of the Soviet state, but of the relentless mechanization of society, gives us the archetype for modern utopianism. Like all fictional utopias, it is less a practical blueprint than a philosophical challenge. Artistically, that challenge was engaged by such works as Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, George Orwell's 1984, and Anthony Burgess's A Clockwork Orange. Utopian works focus on the creation and maintenance of stable social systems. Usually they are science fictions, claiming plausibility against the background of political science. Thomas More invented the word utopia for the title of his 1516 philosophical novel set on an island of that name. More's utopia is a Christian communitarian society. The novel is written in Latin, but the title is in Greek. Readers who find utopia, that is, More's utopia, admirable, cite such details as its personal freedom and general equality. The island is divided into 54 sectors, and anyone may travel freely from one sector to another. When they get to a foreign sector, they may stay in a guest house for free for up to 3 days, and so they can travel wherever they like. If they stay for more than 3 days, they're expected to perform work. Everyone is expected to perform work. And so we have what, in effect, is a communitarian society that nonetheless grants enormous personal freedom. People who think of this as a positive utopia cite such details. Those who find it a satiric utopia cite details such as its uses of gold for shackles and chamber pots and its ironic foreign policy. That is, if we have a situation in which someone really won't work, well, we have to punish them somehow, but no one wants the job of being a jailer, so they just shackle them, and they shackle them with golden shackles. Well, obviously, gold being a highly malleable metal is not well suited for shackles, but it is a sign that More is letting the world know that the utopians disdain money. The love of money, after all, is the root of all evil. This Thomas More, after being killed at the behest of Henry VIII, is the man who becomes St. Thomas More. They also use gold for chamber pots, showing clearly what they think of gold. But the key to me, I think, is the ironic foreign policy. You see, Utopia is an island, and they are peaceful. They don't believe in war. They will not be soldiers, and so instead, they hire mercenaries. Their mercenaries follow a very simple foreign policy. They only want to conquer the islands next to theirs so that they can have a buffer zone around their zone of influence. Of course, once they've conquered those islands, their zone of influence has grown and they need to conquer the islands just next to theirs. If you keep this foreign policy going, eventually it leads to world domination. I think, and I'm in about the one-third of the camp of critics, that this book is meant to be truly ambiguous. It is not a good utopia. It has strong satiric elements that, in fact, let us understand some of the conflict between Thomas More and Henry VIII. This is a critique of English society. And yet, it does hold up the notion of Christian communitarianism as an ideal. We need words for discussing the different kinds of works that try to map out a stable social system. As I say, Moore invented the word utopia, U-T-O-P-I-A. Although the book is in Latin, this is a Greek pun in the title. In English, we would pronounce E-U-T-O-P-I-A, utopia. In Greek, that would be eutopia, or eutopos, a good place. There would also be the word O-U-T-O-P-O-S, meaning no place in Greek, and in Greek that would be pronounced utopos. Eutopos and utopos, good place and no place. To an English reader, they both become utopos. So utopia is a Greek, is an English pun on the Greek word that could mean either a good place or no place. No place in this fallen world is a good place. Today, we use the term dystopia for a bad place. Dys means bad, as in dysphemism, a bad way to say something, versus a euphemism. So dystopia is an undesirable stable society, and utopia can mean either an autopia or the whole category of good, bad, and ambiguous societies. For clarity, I'll use the term autopia when I'm referring to something that is explicitly a good society, dystopia for one that's explicitly a bad society, and utopia for the collectivity of these and the ambiguous ones, which I think was the case with Moore's original model. Once Moore named the genre, its ancient roots became instantly clear. Key historical examples show how utopian literature evolved, especially as commentaries on their own societies. In the ancient world, Plato's Republic, which is in the 4th century before this era, is famous for its banishment of poets in order to maintain social stability, and its rule by guardians, who are philosopher kings. They are chosen, if need be, by the necessary lie, that is, because heredity is a good principle for monarchy in those days, they will claim that the children chosen to join the ranks of the philosopher kings are somehow their offspring, even if they're not. Lying is allowed for the service of the state, as the banishment of imaginative poets is allowed as well. Similarly, the material wealth necessary to maintain the stability of the society is produced by slaves, slavery being an accepted condition in Plato's world, and therefore Plato's utopia, what might be an autopia to Plato's contemporaries, is much more ambiguous to us, and if we side with the slaves, indeed a dystopia. By the Renaissance, we get new kinds of utopias. The Holy Universal Republic in Friar Tommaso Campanella's The City of the Sun, the beginning of the 17th century, abolishes slavery and esteems work. Well, this is understandable in a work coming from a friar. Christianity, after all, begins as it spreads through the Roman world in the first century of this era as a religion among slaves. Slavery is abolished, and how is the material wealth created? By the correct organization of work, by removing competition, people manage to have enough energy left over to produce all that anyone needs, if only people will share properly. So the economics of the first phase of utopia is slavery. The economics of the second Christian phase of utopia is a kind of communism. Francis Bacon, in 1627, published The New Atlantis, another utopia, this one ruled by a long line of scientist kings. He calls this the House of Solomona, obviously a reference to the wisdom of Solomon. And these philosopher kings rule an island much like that in Moore's utopia. In the Industrial Revolution, Edward Bellamy's Looking Backward used an elaborate market system to assign labor fairly and an industrial army to compensate for market inadequacies. That labor market is really worth looking at. This book, published toward the end of the 19th century in America, postulated that people could sell their labor freely and would be rewarded according to the desire the society had for that labor. Everyone would receive the same amount of money, and that was enough money for everyone to live well. If you managed your money well, you got a year's income at a time. If you managed it less well, you got a month's, even a week's, perhaps even a day's. But no one would be allowed to starve. All that could be removed by not allowing you the larger amount of time is the ability to acquire enough capital to buy things that are rather more costly. This is an interesting kind of materialist view of a communist state. But how is all this created, all the wealth that supports everyone? People go to the labor market and they say, well, I would like to be a poet. Well, well and good, but we have lots and lots of poets. If you want to be a poet, you can be a poet. You can have your fixed allotment of goods, but you have to be a poet 18 hours a day. Okay, then I will be a garbage collector. Great, nobody wants to be a garbage collector. You can do that for 2 hours a day. Now, sometimes this didn't work out because maybe nobody wants to be a coal miner, a dangerous occupation. Between the ages of 18 and 25, everyone is conscripted into the industrial army and made to do the jobs that no one else wants to do. But once having earned their way through to 25, they become citizens and can have whatever they like. Bellamy's book led to the creation of over 400 Bellamy clubs in the United States. It is the most important utopian novel in the history of America. And those utopian Bellamy clubs almost elected a president of the United States. However, while it's clear that Bellamy saw this as an a-utopia, others saw it as just the opposite. William Morris in England saw this as a what we would now call fascist, although that word did not exist for him to use, this centralized control, conscription, forcing people to do things that they might not want, and so on. He responded to this by writing his own utopian work, News from Nowhere, in which we find an anarchy. The halls of parliament are used for storing manure, in which everyone, because they want to work, chooses the jobs they like best. And magically, women keep doing serving and men keep doing heavy lifting. But they are indeed happy. It's a throwback. The character who gives our reader the tour says, I drink to the 25th century. I drink to the days that are. We have our childhood back again. In the post-industrial world, that is one in which industrialization has already come upon us, we have works like Karel Čapek's play, R.U.R. That is the title of the play, although we learn in the play that it stands for Rossum's Universal Robots. Robot comes from the word robotir, to labor, in Czech. And in this book, in this play, Karel Čapek invents the modern word robot, which has spread to all modern languages. These robots are not what we would call robots. They're actually what we would call androids, because they are grown in vats rather than assembled by bolting together pieces of metal. But that really makes no difference. What we see here is the question, are we to be ruled by our technology or are we to rule it? You see, we have slaves in the ancient world. We have the organization of work in the Christian Renaissance. But by the time we get into the 19th century, we have wonderful technologies that can allow us, as in news from, as in looking backward, to create the labor that we want, create the wealth that we want, excuse me. But after a while, we have to ask, what is the status of those machines? The machines become ever more wise. In two chapters of Erewhon, which is itself an anagram for nowhere, Samuel Butler's 1872 utopian or dystopian work, the viewpoint character goes to a land in which they have stopped all technological development. Why? These two chapters, known collectively as the Books of the Machine, explain. In London, right then, in 1872, people were on streetcars, and as streetcars approached corners, the conductor of one streetcar would ring a bell to make sure that anybody coming down another street would be warned and stop. After a while, the Erewhonians realized, it would become quite sensible for you to build a tripwire into the trolley path so that the bell goes off automatically. And then after that, it would become quite reasonable to build a sensor into the other trolley so that when the bell goes off, the other trolley stops automatically. And pretty soon you won't need conductors at all. And after that, it's only the next step till machines learn to reproduce themselves. Amazingly, in 1872, Samuel Butler foresees the possibility of the machines ruling us, an image we see, for example, in modern films like The Matrix. The robots, androids we would call them in RUR, eventually cease to be just labor and try to become our masters. The play ends with their revolution in full swing. There are some common issues in all of utopian writing. First of all, we always have to ask, is the imagined society a dystopia, like, say, Brave New World, an autopia, as many think Moore's utopia was, and as Plato clearly thought the Republic was, or is it a utopia, a place inherently ambiguous that makes us think about social stability? Aristophanes' The Clouds in the 4th century before this era satirized Plato's Academy, and it clearly was a dystopia. Valentin André's Christianopolis at the beginning of the 17th century was modeled on John Calvin's Geneva, everyone living in the quarter in which he worked, with all power moving toward the center of the town, and it was clearly an autopia in its author's mind. But as a response to that, perhaps, Thomas Hobbes, or I should say as a response to Moore, Thomas Hobbes wrote Leviathan, asserting the need for absolute monarchy to prevent life from being what he said life would be in a state of nature for a human being, famously, solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. For Hobbes, this centralized control is in fact autopian. I would see it as dystopian. Is the imagined society authoritarian or anti-authoritarian? That's another question we always have to ask. Is it one in which people can run free, as they do to good effect in Morris's News from Nowhere? Or are they in fact made to follow authority to good effect in Hobbes? In all of these cases, whether it is authoritarian or anti-authoritarian, we can still have both autopias or dystopias. Swift, in his Voyage to Laputa, gives us, with his floating island ruled by scientists who impose themselves by violence on the people below, a clear critique of Moore's utopia. Obviously, Laputa tells us that Swift felt that Moore's utopia was a dystopia, because Moore was willing to look only at certain classes while Swift looked at the relations among classes. How can the imagined society produce the economic wherewithal to sustain life? As I say, we have four great historical movements, from slavery to the organization of work to dependence upon machinery to the problematizing of machinery. In the Christian Renaissance, that favored mechanism was the regularization of work, but we see that ultimately that fails because people will do what people need to do. The Industrial Revolution bases its economy on machines, but as Samuel Butler showed us, those machines may eventually make machines of us. We are forced to do what the machines want us to do. You know, time zones were invented not because the sun started to move jerkily across the heavens, but because it was impossible for people to print railway schedules that worked when every town had its own local time. As railways speeded up the travel across the landscape, we needed time zones. And so now we say it's wonderful if we make the trains run on time. But notice, if we catch our commuter train for work, the trains make us run on time. That's the problem that arises in the Industrial Revolution and leads to the dystopias that characterize all of the 20th century. In this post-industrial world, the economy is often based on humans who have become machines. This is not a state most of us would like. In Brave New World, we see this biologically. We're turned out by to be in different classes of workers depending upon how the nutrients are added to the brew as we gestate. In Orwell's 1984, Big Brother watches us to make sure we do only what we are supposed to do. We have to ask of every utopian work, is it an extrapolation from current conditions, or is it a reversal of them? In a work like Charlotte Perkins Gilman's Herland, an a-utopia run by women, in fact, populated only by women, clearly what has happened is that men have been removed and women have brought their sensibility to bear. The details of that interesting utopia don't bear on the current question. What does bear is this, that Herland is a reversal of the conditions of patriarchy that existed at the beginning of the 20th century when Gilman wrote. Whereas, in a work like The Handmaid's Tale by Margaret Atwood, those conditions of patriarchy are extrapolated to the extreme and women become only servants. In the 20th century, most utopian work is in fact dystopian, and the greatest of those dystopian works, it seems to me, is Yevgeny Zamyatin's We, written in 1920. This book was the very first book banned by the Soviet Union, and in fact was not published in the Soviet Union until the late 1980s, when, after the first publication in 1988 under Glasnost of a list rehabilitating previously banned works, Zamyatin's novel was on the very first list of works that should be allowed back in. The plot of We proceeds on two levels. First, we have the viewpoint character who is writing records of his thoughts, record one, record two, and so on through the entire book. He is known as D-503, and he is the chief builder of the Integral. The Integral is a rocket ship which is designed to go and to foreign planets and create mathematically faultless happiness. The very style of the book, in other words, tells us that something is wrong. Human beings cannot be mechanical. We can't have mathematically faultless happiness. At the overt level, we have the political struggle against this united state, or one state, depending upon the translation. But we also have the personal struggle, the covert psychological struggle in that male engineer, D-503. He meets a rebel, I-330, and she induces him to think about the possibility of turning the Integral over to the Mephi, rebels, short for Mephistopheles, I suppose, who would overthrow that state. Everyone lives in a glass city. The city is surrounded by a wall which is called the Green Wall. We have an eversion of Eden here. The wall is green because the vegetation pressing in from the outside makes the glass look green. Everyone lives in glass apartments, and they may draw the curtains only when they're having sex. They may have sex at the appointed sexual time, the sexual hour, which is noted on the table of hours, which regularizes everybody's work. The problem in this novel, having to do with the Soviet Union, is clear. We have a mechanical system, everyone is told what to do, a centralized economy, and so on. But I think this work is a classic because it goes well beyond its historical, its moment of historical composition. A fast reading of the book suggests that D-503 falls away from the United States because of his erotic attraction to I-330. But I think that's false. This is how the book begins, the very first record. D-503 writes, "This is merely a copy, word for word, of what was published this morning in the state newspaper. Quote, in another 120 days, the building of the Integral will be completed, the historic hour, etc., etc., etc." What D-503 is doing is writing down what has already been written in the state newspaper. But the thing that has been written is talking about the glory of the work for which he is the head engineer. He is not allowed to demonstrate his own ego, and he realizes he shouldn't. And so he's trying to fight against the egotism that will separate the I from the we, and says, this is merely a copy, word for word, of what was published this morning in the state newspaper. He's claiming mechanical production so as to retain his humanity. In fact, that desire to be himself is what really marks the beginning of his apostasy. The novel brilliantly combines the romantic with the mechanical. People, as you already have heard, have numbers instead of names. D503, R13 is the lowest numbered character, S4711 the highest. S4711 is one of the guardians. R13, a poet. With broad lips, spittle comes out as he talks. Dark skin. American readers might think, R13 is the lowest class character. He is clearly a black man. Obviously, the Russians are disparaging him. But we need to understand, in Russian literature, the greatest romantic poet is Pushkin, who was part African. And all Russians knew that. Pushkin was proud of his African heritage. And so what Zamyatin has done is said, the man that would have been excluded, in fact, is at the heart of this story. Not at the machine of this story, the engine of this story, but the heart of this story. The system goes on. If your name begins with a vowel, you're a woman. With a consonant, you're a man. The higher the number, the higher the social status, and so on. Everything is regulated. There is a lex sexualis, the sexual law, that says a number, meaning a citizen, may obtain a license to use any other number as a sexual product. The very style sees the clash between the romantic and the mechanical. For example, L equals F of D, written out like the algebraic formula. Love is the function of death. And yet, perhaps it is. Without love, we have no reproduction. Without reproduction, we have no birth and death. It's meaningless to talk about the death of an amoeba who is itself the 12th generation of amoebae who keeps splitting and producing identical amoebae. The insights of this book, for example, about the values of knives, make us think more generally. The knife, we're told, is the most solid, the most immortal, the most inspired invention of man. The knife served on the guillotine. The knife is the universal tool for cutting knots. The way of paradoxes follows its sharp edge, the only way becoming to a fearless mind. The knife stands for all of science, and it can cut either way, to the good or the bad. Desires are tortures, aren't they? It is clear, therefore, that happiness is when there are no desires any longer, not a single desire anymore. At first we think, this is insane. How could I live without desire? And then one thinks, yes, but if I didn't have the hunger that would make a meal piquant, I could never have the hunger that makes me feel that I'm starving. At the end of the novel, it turns out that every character in this book is described in terms of his mouth and his teeth. The teeth are the knives of the body. And so what we see is the central image of this book is a kind of combination of knives and teeth. And we have to see who has what kind of power and whether that power will be vampiric, to bite our neck, or loving, to kiss our neck. Ultimately, D503, watches I-330 have the air sucked out of her. And on the last page of the book, he thinks about that woman whom he no longer remembers. Her teeth were very white and were pretty. He can't remember her because the operation to remove fancy has knifed into his brain and taken away his imagination. Right now, there is still a revolt in the western part of the city, but the Transverse Avenue 40 is a place where we have succeeded in establishing a temporary wall of high voltage waves. And I, D30 says, now having changed, hope we will win. More than that, I am certain we shall win. Reason must prevail. Reason means the life without imagination. This is a terrible, tragic ending. 40 is the name of the avenue. 40 records. 40 the days of suffering. Will we be transformed by reading this book? Zamyatin asks us to think what we create in this modern world and have the imagination to do better.